being with us on Wednesday night. You know, the classes are going on already. We're starting, I guess, upstairs. Well, I'm on time tonight, right on time. Amen. But as we get started, let me remind you of a few things that are going on. I didn't see a bullet. I didn't find my bullets, and I don't know where I placed it. It wasn't in my office. So if I missed something, you let me know. Thank y'all. First of all, thank you for being here Sunday night. We had a great baptism. Had four souls that were baptized Sunday night. And we had to pray over the pizza so that it would be multiplied. We were under the short. Like fish in the load. Norma said she was multiplied. This Saturday morning, 10 o'clock to 12 o'clock, 12 o'clock, that's this Saturday, here at the church in the kitchen, and they're just asking if you'd like to come, bring a brunch dish that you can share with everybody. They normally will have a brunch or breakfast, and then they do different things, bring the word and share with time together. All the ladies are invited to that this Saturday at 10 o'clock. A few other things that I'd like to mention is also the Happy Seniors of Faith. They have taken off through the summer. The senior adults that meet once a month have taken off through June and July, but they are going to have a fellowship on August the 22nd. Am I right, Elaine? I'm getting that right. August the 22nd. And I think she's got a sign-up sheet for food in there.
Yeah.
Amen. And also at the end of this month, the last Wednesday night of the month, we will be back in our routine of having family night where we eat together before the service. It will be, of course, served at 6 o'clock, and then church starts at 7. There is also a sign-up sheet on the bulletin board if you'd like to bring help bring the food and help bring the meal that night also. Please check that out. Let's plan and have a great night of fellowship for family night. One more thing, a few more things. One more thing, tomorrow night we've got a wedding here at the church. It will be Raymond Hughes and his future, or his fiancée, his soon-to-be bride, Sopa. And if you know them, they will ask me just to announce it, to remind you. You don't have to RSVP or anything. They just said show up. It'll be something simple and intimate. And then they'll have refreshments and cake afterwards. So if you know them and you're able to come, they are inviting you to come tomorrow night here at the church at 7 o'clock for that wedding. Amen. I also want to say this. I kept slipping my mind, but I wanted to thank Michael Carter. He came over here right before Vacation Bible School, and he pressure washed the whole church and cleaned the cook shed. And I want to recognize him. I appreciate him doing it. And I'm looking at you, I want to say something about it. Not that he did it to be recognized, but I wanted to recognize him. And they was this morning, the ladies was here cleaning. Sister Lane was out here cutting bushes and cleaning the flower beds. Thank you for all of the work. And I don't always see things that go on. Sometimes I don't recognize you. It's not maybe because I may forget or not seen. Please don't be offended by that. I try not to miss you, or try to recognize you when I can. But thank you for all of the work that goes on around this church and in this church that on a daily basis and a weekly basis. So thank you for serving the Lord. Amen. I believe that's all the announcements at this time. But if you will, let's stand up all over the house. Amen. And we're going to go to the Lord in prayer as we get started this evening. All right, brother, I'm turning it over to you. Pray for us and open us up this evening.
Let's pray. Thank you, Lord, for this wonderful day, God, you've given us. Thank you for this opportunity to come into your house and worship you, Lord. I pray right now, Father, that our hearts and minds are set on you, Lord, that the atmosphere of worship will just come into this place, God, and we'll just give you honor and glory, Father. Thank you for Jesus. In his name we pray. Everybody said
it.
Amen. Lord, he ain't got to pray. If you're in the battle for the Lord and God, oh,
Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy. forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted. You were condemned. I'm alive and well. Your Spirit is within me because you died for me.
My joy to honor.
got your Bibles, if you want to be finding 2 Peter, 2 Peter is where we're going this evening. Amen. Have our folks, they're going to hand out our notes until you later. I don't know, I've got 45. Some of you may have to share. This is the same thing, it's just on two pages. I always give it to you. Amen. Thank you again. Thank you for being here this evening on Wednesday night. I'm always grateful to be in the house and the love of the Lord in the middle of the week. And I enjoy Wednesday nights because I would go at it at a little bit of a different perspective. You know, not necessarily preaching, but I like teaching and like giving you some notes. It's something that you can take home and maybe you can go back and study it out yourself. That's what I encourage you to do. With this, so I hope that Wednesday nights help you and maybe strengthen you in your faith and give you a better understanding of each book that we make our way through. We've been going through some of the New Testament books, the epistles, the letters that were written by some of the apostles. We've gone through some things that Paul wrote, and we've been working on Peter. We've worked on 1 Peter for about 6 weeks. And now we finished that last Wednesday night, and we're going to go ahead and move on into 2 Peter. We probably will not be here as long because 2 Peter only has 3 chapters versus 1 Peter that had 5 chapters. So we'll just see. Sometimes I say that, and then I end up sticking around for a few more chapters or a few more sermons, whatever the Lord brings out of this. But I just want to share with you this study on 1 Peter and 2 Peter, excuse me. And when we start a new book or a new epistle like this, a lot of times I give you a lot of information to start with about the setting of it and some other things like that. And we're going to get into that this morning or this evening. So don't go to sleep on me as we get started. Amen. Be sharing with you some facts to begin with as we get started. But as they finish in getting those passed out, look at 2 Peter. We're going to look at chapter 1, and we're just going to read the first 10 verses tonight, and then we'll pray and we'll get into some of that that I have put in your hands, some of those notes. 2 Peter, I keep saying first. If I say first tonight, you just know I mean second. Amen. 2 Peter, beginning in chapter 1, beginning in verse 1. Are you there? Say amen.
Amen.
Amen. It says this, Simon Peter, a bondservant and apostle of Jesus Christ, to those who have obtained like precious faith with us by righteousness of our God and Savior, Jesus Christ. So he's writing this unto the saved, amen, that have that same precious faith as Peter. He goes on in verse 2, grace and peace be multiplied to you in the knowledge of God and our Lord, as divine power has given us all things that pertain to life and godliness through the knowledge of Him. Notice you're going to see a lot of this where he says knowledge of Him who's called us by glory and virtue, by which we have been given to us exceedingly great and precious promises, that through these you may be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped corruption that is in the world through lust. Verse 5, but also for this very reason, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue, to virtue knowledge, to knowledge self-control, to self-control perseverance, to perseverance godliness, to godliness brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness, love. For if these things are yours and abound, you will neither be barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. For he who lacks these things is short-sighted and even to blindness, and has forgotten that he was cleansed from his old sins. Verse 10, therefore, brethren, be even more diligent to make your call and election sure, for if you do these things, you will never stumble. Amen. Let's stop right there tonight, and let's pray over the reading of God's Word and pray over this sermon this evening. Heavenly Father, we come before you tonight in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. We are grateful and humbled to be in your house tonight. Thank you once again for an opportunity to share your word. And Lord, as I stand here, every time I stand here, Lord, I need your anointing. I need your touch. Touch my mind that it may be sharp and clear and speak the thoughts in which you have given me. Touch my tongue. God, as I am tongue-tied and stammering already, God, touch me that I may speak your word clearly unto your people. And I pray, God, tonight that they would receive from your word nourishment, some meat, oh God, to feed their hungry souls, Lord. Lord, we also pray your hand upon all of our teachers and all of our classes, the children, and through all the way up through the high school. Please minister to those classes tonight. Let hearts be touched and changed in the mighty name of Jesus. And everybody said,
amen.
Amen. And amen. And before we get to diving into this scripture here, as I told you a minute ago, every time I begin a new book or a new epistle we start into, I like to give you a few facts about that. And so let's do that real quick. It's on your paper here, but I like to share this and to set the picture of 2 Peter. This short epistle or letter was written by Peter after he was arrested by Nero. And it was written just before he was crucified upside down around 65 A.D. or 66 A.D. Tradition tells us that Peter would not be crucified the same way that Jesus was, but they literally flipped him upside down and crucified him. That's the way that the Apostle Peter died. But going on, it says 1 Peter was not actually, or excuse me, 2 Peter, I got down there 1 Peter. 2 Peter was dictated and recorded by Sylvanus. 2 Peter is so different from 1 Peter, the one we've been studying. They're so different from 1 Peter to 2 Peter. Many scholars and many theologians thought that the Apostle Peter did not write that second epistle. They began to doubt it because there were so many differences. And some of the notes that I saw on this particular letter, it said this, that the elegant Greek writing of the first one was very different from that of the second one. But as we read this epistle, we know without a doubt that he did write it. I'll tell you in a moment why it's different. Well, he did write 2 Peter because he said he did. It's very clear there at the very beginning of this chapter we see. Also, he gives in chapter 1 of 2 Peter, he gives his own account of the account of the transfiguration when Jesus took him, James, and John up on a mountain and Jesus was transfigured. In other words, he was glorified, and all of a sudden, Elijah and Moses were there talking to him. He gives an account a little bit of this, and we're going to read that in just a moment. Just give you some facts about 2 Peter. Peter knew also in this letter that he would be accounted. He would be martyred. I've got to get my words together. Amen. My sugar flow. I feel like I'm jittery tonight. Amen. But he knew in this epistle that he would be martyred. Jesus had told him in so many words in John chapter 21 that when you were young, Peter, you dressed yourself and you went where you wanted to go. But he says in John 21, he says, but Peter, when you're old, others will dress you and they will lead you where you do not want to go, the Bible says. And lastly, we know that Peter wrote this because he mentions the previous epistle in chapter 3. So on all accounts, we believe that this was his epistle. And just like Paul's epistle in 2 Timothy, this is Peter's last will and testament, so to speak, because this is the last letter that he would write before his death. Now let me address to you for just a moment why 1 Peter and 2 Peter are so different. They're so different that scholars say, well, I don't even know if Peter wrote the second verse or wrote the second letter. Well, what we need to understand and what we must recognize is this, is that the purpose in these two letters was very different. Now, let me share with you this. Over the last 6 weeks, we have been focusing on the first one. And I have told you over and over who it was written to and why it was written. The first epistle of Peter, it was written unto the first century church that was suffering persecution. They were suffering persecution from the Romans, and they were also suffering at the hands of the Jewish people. His first epistle was to equip believers for persecution from without. It was to encourage Christians under the threat of violent maltreatment, and it was to encourage them to stand up under outside pressure. Everybody say outside. Outside pressure. The world was putting pressure upon them. The Romans were putting pressure on the Christians. They were crucifying Christians. They were doing other terrible things under Christian Jewish people. We know that Paul, during this time, or before he became Paul, he was Saul, and he oversaw the death of Christians. So they were facing outside pressure from the Romans and the Jews. And that's why he writes the first epistle to encourage them, but the second one's different. The second letter is different. He writes this time to get them to reject from perversion from within. We're going to see as we get into the next chapter, and in chapter 2, that 2 Peter is written to encourage the Christians to stand against lies and heresy. Pressure from within. The other was pressure from the world, but now the devil has crept in and into the church, and heresies and lies are being told, and confusion of who Christ is comes, and he tells them and he encourages them to stand under the pressure. Last Wednesday night, let me explain it to you like this. Last Wednesday night, as we concluded in the first Peter, I spoke to you about what I call the persecution of the devil. When the church exploded on the day of Pentecost, that was the day the Holy Spirit came, and a mighty move in Jerusalem. The Bible says 3,000 were saved there in Jerusalem, and that the church added to that number daily. Can I tell you what that did? That really ticked off the devil. And from there, it ticked off. He was already mad, Brother Tim, because Jesus, had 50 days before that, had walked out of the grave, amen, out of the tomb, victorious over death, hell, and the grave. But now, there were thousands upon thousands of once under the darkness of Satan, now being saved and brought into the marvelous light of salvation in Christ Jesus. So the devil's mad, amen. Because Jesus is alive, he's victorious, people's getting saved, so the devil hatched a plan. The devil hatched a plan, and he said, let me put it into the hearts of men to persecute this church. Let me put it into the hearts of men in which that we will bring pressure upon them, and we will slander the church, and we will ridicule the church, and we will even harm the church. But that plan failed. Outside pressure failed. You want to know why? Because when they put outside pressure on the church, it spread the gospel and it did not hinder the gospel. His plan backfired. Listen in Acts chapter 8, verse 1. It says this, now Saul was consenting to his death. That's talking about Stephen. And at this time, a great persecution rose against the church, which is that was at Jerusalem. Remember, that's where it all started. That's where the Holy Spirit fell upon the 120 in the upper room, and thousands were saved. He said, persecution come upon them. And they were what? Scattered throughout all the regions of Judea and Samaria. So the devil thought, and the Romans thought, and the Jews thought, well, we're going to snuff out these Christians and this movement about this Christ and this Lord and this Savior. They said, let's put some pressure on them. But it backfired, and it actually did exactly what Jesus said they were going to do. Now let's look at Acts chapter 1, verse 8. We're going to switch the numbers around. He said, this, wait in Jerusalem, and you're going to receive the power of the Holy Spirit, and you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem, and in where? All of Judea and Samaria. That was at the beginning of the book of Acts. In other words, when that persecution came upon the church, the word of God began to spread just like Jesus said that it was going to happen. They went to the north, which is Samaria. They were spread and scattered to the south, and they took the gospel with them, and eventually it spread, we know, to the uttermost parts of the world. So what I'm saying is, did the devil's plan of persecuting the church fail? It failed miserably. It backfired, in other words. So then he had to come up with plan B. Instead of persecuting the church from without, he decided, well, let me pervert it from within. The attack of the enemy moved from the outside to the inside. And that's what 2 Peter is all about. When we get to chapter 2, we're going to see that the entire focus is on false teachers and destructive doctrines. We studied a little bit about this in Colossians several months back. And if you remember one particular lie or false teaching that was talked about in that study was Gnosticism. That's this belief or this idea that knowledge is salvation. They believed that you had to have a special revelation or a special word from God in order to be saved. They denied that Jesus Christ was enough. These people denied that Jesus Christ was enough. If you ever sit under any teaching, you listen to it on the radio, go to a church, or you watch it on TV, and if in any way they say that Christ is not enough for your salvation, there's something else you need to do, then you turn that junk off just as fast as you knew it. Because Jesus Christ is enough. And this was a lie that was perpetrated and that began to spread in the early church, that Christ was not enough. One thing was this, the Gnostics, they thought that you had to have some kind of special revelation in order to get to heaven. And we know that some of the Jewish Christians later on, they talk about how you had to be circumcised in order to be a Christian. And they face all of that in the book of Acts. But let me tell you something, Jesus is enough. Amen? He is enough for you and me to get to heaven. Now, when we repent of our sins and we place our faith in Jesus Christ, the Bible says that we are saved by grace. Amen. Through faith. Jesus Christ is enough, church. But during this time, false teachings and heresies were prevalent. They were spreading like wildfire within the church. They were perverting the gospel. Do you know what? That's no different than today. Solomon said there's nothing new under the sun. Amen. What was going on then is still happening today. You can guarantee that. We're seeing that. And we have warnings in almost every book of the New Testament about not being deceived and warnings against false teachers. Do you know that Jesus talked about false teachers? That Peter did, Paul did, Jude did, and John did. They all warned us about teachers that pervert the gospel. See, what I want you to understand is this. Perversion within the church is much worse than persecution from without. Perversion within the church is much more worse than persecution from without. As we study, when we look at history, persecution from the outside has always cleansed the motives and strengthened the commitment of believers. But false teachings in the church, from the pulpit, from a classroom, has always weakened the church. Man. It's always attacked the lordship of Christ. It always has hindered the testimony of believers. And so what I'm telling you tonight, church, it is imperative that we know the word of truth today. So it's imperative that we preach the truth in our classes. It's imperative that we preach it from the pulpit today.
Yes, Lord.
Because there's so much deception. The Bible warns us of this. And I thought of kind of a way maybe to think about it and illustrate it, the work of Satan. You know, it's amazing the technology that we have these days. That you can, through the internet, you can meet anybody.
Amen.
You can talk to anybody. You can talk to somebody through Facebook, through Messenger. You can get on different in these what they call chat rooms or match websites, and you can meet anybody and everybody. And we know that this has been in the news before, where there have been men or women that would get on these sites and they would post fake pictures and post fake stories and act like they were somebody else. Haven't we heard of that? A young, maybe a teenager being abducted or being harmed in some kind of way because they met somebody online that was not who they said that they were? And they put these pictures on there, and they put up a front story. Oh, it made them sound like the most wonderful man or the most wonderful woman in the world. But then when they actually meet them, like, wow, now you ain't who I thought you was. Amen. I said that to say this. Be careful on them dating websites. That's what I was calling them. But I said that to say this. I do believe this, that the devil has a way of doing the very same thing. He has a way, especially in 2019, he has been producing what I call a fake profile of Christ within the churches. A fake profile. In other words, we got a picture of Jesus. But yet, this is the thing. We many times, a twisted version of Christ is preached. A twisted version of the Word of God is preached. A twisted version by, let me take this out, and let me take this out, and let me just give them what they want to hear. That's a fake profile of who Christ is. And what I'm saying is we need to be very careful who it is that we listen to. We need to be very careful to the teaching that we listen to and make sure that we are following Christ and make sure that we're not following the world's vision of Christ. Amen. The picture of Christ in the Word of God many times can be very different from the world's perspective of who Christ is.
Amen.
I'm going to preach this a little bit on Sunday morning. I preached last Sunday morning about coming as you are. Jesus accepts you as you are. Bring all your sin, bring all your mess, bring all your mistakes, bring all of your brokenness, that Jesus loves you and will accept you, and He will save you and meet you right where you are. I'm going to finish that sermon this Sunday morning, that I want you to come as you are, but don't stay that way. God wants you to come as you are. Bring your brokenness, bring your mess, but don't stay. You're not to stay as you are. But see, there is a gospel and there is the teachings of today in the United States of America. Hey, Jesus loves you exactly the way that you are. You don't have to change. God created you that way. Just stay right the way that you are. That's a twisted gospel.
Amen.
That's a twisted gospel.
Amen.
And so we have to be careful of what we hear and what we listen to. Perversion within the church is far worse than persecution from without. Now let's get to the actual scripture a little bit here. I just want to point out a few things tonight. In 2 Peter, you find that he spoke a lot about knowledge. And that's why I believe that he was combating, he was dealing with this heresy of Gnosticism, this idea of knowledge having to do with getting to heaven, a special knowledge or a special revelation. But he talks about knowledge, but he talks about the knowledge of God. He talks about the knowledge of the Word of God and knowing Christ deeply. See, knowledge matters. What you know matters. Did you know that? There's two Greek words that Peter used as he is writing this epistle for the English, where we get knowledge. But they have a little bit of a different meaning. Let's look at these two words right here. Gnosis. That word means to know. A mental awareness of information. Peter used that word, that Greek word, 9 times. That's how we commonly see knowledge, isn't it? Just to a mental awareness of information. But he uses another form of knowledge in the Greek that is called epignosis. Epignosis. That epi meaning we get the word epic or great from in English. Epignosis. He used it 4 different times. It means deep, full, complete, insightful grasp of truth principles. And he uses it 4 particular times in scriptures, and each one of these times is connected to deeply and intimately knowing Christ. Let me give you an example between those two words. Let me just simplify it for just a minute with this example. You might know that Donald Trump is the president of the United States of America, but do you know him? You know that he is the president of the United States. He's your president, whether you like it or not. But do you know him? I don't know him. Do you know him, Dan?
Yeah,
I know him. Play golf. You used to play golf with him? Yeah, right. Ride motorcycle. You don't know him. There's a difference. Okay, I know about somebody, but I don't know them. And so he stresses here that we need a deep, intimate knowledge of Christ, and we need to know the Word of God. It's exactly what Paul was saying in Philippians chapter 3 when he says this, that I may know Him. That I may know Him. Not just know about Him. Not just know facts about Him or facts about the Bible, but I may know Him and the power of His resurrection and the fellowship of His suffering. Daniel chapter 11 uses it in a little bit of a different way in verse 32. Those that do wickedly against the covenant, he shall corrupt with flattery. But the people who know their God shall be strong and carry out great exploits. What is my point in this? Strength comes by knowing your God. Strength comes by knowing your God. Knowledge of the Word, deep personal relationship with Christ is the only way to combat false teaching. Did you hear what I'm saying? False teaching is prevalent, not just in the world, but in the churches today. And the only way that we can combat that, the only way that we can stand against false teaching is you knowing deeply this Word. Amen? The reason that so many Christians are being led astray to the left and to the right is because they've got a surface level knowledge of the Word of God. You think you know what it says. You've got an idea, well, I think I remember this verse, this verse, this verse. But do you know what the Word of God says? Do you have that relationship with Jesus Christ? The only way that you're going to fight off falsehood is by knowing the truth. Man. Listen to me, and I want to encourage you. I do my very best to preach the Word of God. And I try to give you example after example after example from the Scriptures. Amen. I always pick Brother Tim because he'll say, well, you was on it, or he would make this comment. Because he said he always checks me to make sure that I'm right. And I said, well, good. I want you to. I want you to. Because I don't want to ever preach something that's not the truth. Amen. But we need to know the Word of God, church.
Yes, Lord.
This is it. This is our foundation. This is what we stand upon. And I believe that so many are led astray by a smooth-mouthed preacher or teacher that follow them anywhere because they just get surface-level knowledge of the Word of God. We need to know this Word, amen. To know the Word is to know Christ. You want a deeper relationship with Christ? We can stand around all day and say, oh, Lord, talk to me. Please, sir. He says, I have talked to you. I got it right here. You want to know Christ. If you want to pick it up, pick Him up right here. Begin to digest this Word. I'm telling you, there's danger, especially as we move into these last days. There is danger in not knowing the Word of God. And I preach it as hard as I can, and I give you just as much examples in Scripture as I can every Sunday morning, Sunday night, and Wednesday night. But listen to me right now, church. Don't just take that what I spoon and feed you through the week.
Amen.
Why is it? Who in the world would go on that kind of diet? To eat, think about physically, if you ate nothing, I ain't going to eat nothing through the week. I'm going to eat something on Wednesday night. And then on Sunday, I'm just going to cram it all in. How healthy do you think you'd be physically if that's the only times you ate? Physically, you'd be starved to death, wouldn't you? Be malnutrition. And some of you, that's the only time you eat. You eat on Wednesday night, we get the Word on Wednesday night, and you get it on Sunday morning and Sunday night, and that's the only time you get the Word. Amen? Come on now. We wouldn't do that physically. So why do we want to live on that kind of spiritual diet? Amen? I just want to stress to you, Jesus, Peter, John, Paul, all of them warned us over and over and over in Scripture. Do not be deceived that false antichrists and false prophets would come and lies and deception would come in the last days. And what I'm just stressing tonight out of this epistle is to prepare yourself, guard yourself with the Word of truth.
Amen.
Let me move on off that soapbox. Amen. faith. We don't have to have a blind faith. We have a faith that knows and a faith that rests in His Word. We need a mature knowledge of the truth. Amen? That's what I'm stressing tonight. Now, notice this right here. He opens up this letter with Simon Peter, he calls him. That's why I say his full name. Simon was his name before he got saved, and Peter was his name before, was really after he got saved. That's the name that Jesus gave him. That name Simon, do you know that it means to be unstable? Simon was always unstable in his actions, but later on Jesus called him a rock. He said, "And upon this rock I'm going to build my church." Amen. Do you know what I desire for you as a people is those that are unstable in God and in Christ, unstable in His Word, I want you to become a rock. I want you to become stable in the Word of God. I want you to become rooted in the Word of God. We don't want to stay like Simon, unstable and wavering. But we want to get rooted in our faith, and we want to know the principles and the truth of the Word of God. We need a faith that knows. Say that with me. A faith that knows. We need a precious faith that knows. Why? I want to point out to you five things here from these verses 2 through 4. Let's read that again. Grace and peace be multiplied to you in the knowledge of God. Notice that word, in the knowledge of God and of Jesus Christ. As His divine power has given to us all things that pertain to life and godliness through the knowledge of Him who has called us by His glory and virtue. He begins pointing out some things that are revealed to us through the knowledge of God. The first thing there he said was grace. Everybody say grace.
Grace.
I don't want you falling asleep on me as I'm just stuttering all the way through this sermon. Grace. Think about this. Grace. That's what saves us. That's what we are saved by, grace through faith.
Yes.
And Romans chapter 1:16 says this about our salvation. For I'm not ashamed of the gospel. That's the knowledge of God. That is the truth. For it's the power of God to salvation for everyone who believes. Amen. Understand that pardon and forgiveness come through the knowledge of Jesus. Do you not know that it was not for this word, for the knowledge of God? This is what brings about and reveals to us grace. God, the knowledge of God reveals grace. Secondly, it reveals peace, or it brings peace. Without the knowledge of God, do you know what? We can't have peace. Notice it says grace and peace. Grace and peace in verse 2. It does not say peace and grace. I believe that the Bible is specific. Why does it put it like that? Because, see, you cannot have peace without His grace.
That's right.
You can't have true peace without His grace. It's kind of like a sign I remember seeing, a church sign I remember seeing. It's on your paper, "Know God, N-O God, N-O peace." But "know God," K-N-O-W, and "know peace." To the knowledge of God, we find grace. To the knowledge of God, we also find peace. We find through knowledge the forgiveness of our sins. We also learn this, that He's going to take care of us in His Word, don't we? He also says in His Word that He's going to make sure that all things work for good. We're going to read and we find that we've been forgiven and pardoned through the knowledge of God. The third thing that He says is through the knowledge of God we learn is all things pertaining to life. Do you know that Christ gives us all things that you need to make it through this life? Christ gives you all things that you need to make it through this life. The knowledge of God equips you for every season. Yeah. How do I know that? 2 Timothy chapter 3. All Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, instruction, and righteousness. Listen to this part. That the man of God may be what? Complete. And thoroughly what? Equipped. For every good work. Pertaining to all of life. Through the knowledge of God, we find equipment in the Word of God. Through the knowledge of God, we find godliness. Knowledge empowers us to live godly in Christ. Listen to what David said in Psalms 119, verse 11. He says this, "Your word I have hidden in my heart that I might not sin against you." Knowledge of the word of God brings sanctification. It brings the promises of God. Think about this. It says this a little bit further down in what we've read. He says, "By which we've been given to us exceedingly great and precious promises." Where do we find the promises of God? In the word of God. Amen. Think about this. Promises come by knowledge in the word of God. You can't claim what you don't know. You can't claim what you don't know. Think about we used to sing this song, "Standing on the Promises of God." Amen. When we have knowledge in the word of God and knowledge of God, we have something to stand on.
Amen.
You ever thought about that? We have something to stand on. Amen. Knowledge of God brings us stability. It brings us power. It brings us strength. I want you to listen to this ending of chapter 1 in verses 16. You can flip over there. But Peter stresses that we can depend upon the Holy Scripture. He says this. I'm going to read the whole little passage there. "For we did not follow cunning devised fables when we made known to you the power of the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but were eyewitnesses of His majesty." We trust this word because Peter saw it. Amen. He saw Jesus face to face. Can you imagine that? He saw also the glory and the power of His majesty. "For He received from God the Father honor and glory, for such a voice came to Him from the excellent glory, 'This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased.' And we heard this voice that came from heaven when we were with Him on the holy mountain." This is talking about the transfiguration. He was there when he saw Jesus glorified and Moses and Elijah talking. "And so we have the prophetic word confirmed, which you do well to heed, as a light that shines in a dark place until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts, knowing this first, that no prophecy of Scripture is given of any private interpretation." And another word for that is origin. "For prophecy never came by the will of man, but by holy men of God who spoke as they were moved on by the Holy Spirit."
Amen.
That's exactly how the Word of God has come about. Amen. It is not the origin of any man. And he stresses that unto us. But it's when the Holy Spirit moved upon men of God that the Word of God was spoken and it was breathed. We can trust the Scriptures tonight. We can rest upon them. We can draw strength from them. They bring the promises of God. These Scriptures lead us into godliness. They equip us to all things pertaining unto life. Now let me say the last part right here. Faith. We need a faith that knows, and we need a faith that grows.
Amen.
We need a faith that knows. It's rooted in the Word of God. But we also need a faith that grows. Let's look at the last part of this tonight. 2 Peter chapter 1, beginning in verse 5. "But also for this reason, giving all diligence, add to your faith." Say that with me. Add to your faith. This has nothing to do with salvation there. Don't think, well, I have to add these in order to be saved. That's not what he's saying. But he says, add these in order to grow in grace and to grow in your faith. And we'll read it again. He says, add to your faith virtue. To virtue, knowledge. To knowledge, self-control. To self-control, perseverance. To perseverance, godliness. To godliness, brotherly kindness. And to brotherly kindness, he says, add love.
Amen.
Faith, he says, we must have a faith that knows. It's rooted in this word, but a faith that grows. You know that growing is your responsibility. And he says, give all diligence to that. Give all diligence. So, you know one of the reasons that most people aren't growing in the faith? They're not growing in Christ because they're not diligent about their growing. They have this idea, well, I got saved, I gave my heart to the Lord, I got baptized, well, I'm done. I'm finished. I'm good. But that's not the way it goes, church. We are commanded to grow in grace. Listen to how Peter ends this epistle in 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 18, he says this, "But grow in the grace and the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To him be the glory both now and forever." Let me tell you something, Christian. You're not a stick stuck in the ground.
Amen.
You're not a stick that's just stuck in the ground. He is a. You are a plant, a tree planted by the waters that should be growing, flourishing.
Amen.
You know what happens when you stop? A tree stops growing. Decay sets in. When a plant stops growing, decay sets in. When we stop growing in Christ, do you know what? We start decaying.
Amen.
Think about these two verses in verse 8 and 9, and I'm about to be finished. "For if these things are yours and abound," he said, "if you add these things, you will neither be barren nor fruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. For he lacks these things is short-sighted, even to blindness, and has forgotten that he is cleansed from his old sins." He says, man, if we say, well, I don't need to grow in Christ, if I don't need to mature in Christ, he says, man, we have even forgotten you've forgotten the mercy. You've forgotten about the grace. You've forgotten what has been done for you. Now let me back, if you will, back up, Amanda, one slide there. We need a grace that knows. We need a grace that's growing. And then, you know what? We'll have a grace that shows. A faith that shows. I'm sorry. Listen to verse 8. "Therefore, if these things are yours and abound, you will be neither barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ." He says that when we have a grace that knows, a faith that knows, and a faith that knows and a faith that grows, he said, we'll have a faith that shows. Stand your feet all over the house this evening. I have stumbled enough tonight. I cannot get my mind and my head clear tonight for anything. Amen. We're going to close out a little bit differently tonight. Just leave your stuff right where it is. And I want us to make a circle all the way around the perimeter of this building. Can we do that tonight? Come right here. Just go to that wall. Go to the back wall. Come across, if you're physically able, if you're not physically